All right, good evening, community groups. And I think we're in week 4 or 5 of this series on family ties, guarding and keeping the unity that exists in the body of Christ through the bonds of peace. And we've covered a number of different issues. Last week was a big one, forgiveness, dealing with the resentment that so easily sits in our hearts. And then this last Sunday, we looked at manipulation, coercion, and setting boundaries to prevent that from kind of happening in our lives or happening towards us. And just to recap a little bit, when we're talking about manipulation or coercion, we're talking about attempts either from ourselves or others to try and control and influence the actions of others in our favor. And so if I want to manipulate somebody, I might use some guilt tactics, or I might use some intimidation tactics to try and get them to do what I want them to do. In other words, I'm diminishing the person's freedom of choice to choose from a wide variety of options, how they want to respond to my request or so on. Coercion then is when I perhaps get a little bit more intimidating, I perhaps try to use my authority, I raise my voice or whatever it is to try and coerce you into doing what I want you to do. The Bible's very clear that God gives us freedom. He gives us freedom. We are to pursue that freedom in Christ, that incredible freedom that we have in Christ, which means that God gives us the freedom to even chart our own own lives and walk according to our own purposes, to reject him if we want to. He gives us that much freedom. And so kind of the flow from that is that we expected to give others the same kind of freedom. But we're selfish. We like to get what we want. We like to get other people to do what we want them to do. And so all of us are susceptible to the temptation of manipulation or coercion from time to time. And we've all felt that kind of tough space where you feel pushed into a corner that you have to respond in a certain way because somebody is trying to manipulate you or pressurize you into answering in a certain way. And so we talked around that on Sunday. What I want to do tonight for our purposes in terms of discussion in community is look at how that kind of can play out even in the church. It obviously plays out in families and all relationships, but I thought let's have a look at how it can play out in the church, because at the end of the day, we're called to guard the unity in the church. We're called to obviously look after our marriages, guard the unity in our families, but we're also called to guard the unity of the body of Christ. And so just a couple of thoughts as to how this can play out in church life, and then what we'll do is we'll just use this as a platform to discuss it further in community, maybe some experiences that you've had in church life, hopefully not ours, but maybe in your previous church or encounters with friends and so on along the way. Just 5 quick examples. The first one we touched on Sunday was the kind of God told me scenario. And it's laced with manipulation. It could even be coercive. When somebody comes up to you and they say, I've got a word for you, and I had this vision and God told me, and this is what's going to happen. And you know, because of the way that you feel, you're feeling, well, I don't really have a choice. I don't feel the same, but what option do I have? Because the person said, God told them. And so that can often be used, whether it's intentional or not, but it can be manipulative or coercive. What we prefer to do, for example, at Lighthouse, is even if you have a very clear picture or a word for somebody, rather go up to them and say, you know, I sense that this word could be for you. I know it might just sound like semantics, but it comes across a lot softer, giving you the freedom to witness with that or not. And if you don't witness with it, that's fine. But when we use language like God told me to, or you know, sometimes people use this funny language, King James language, or they develop this funny tone when they're going to share a word with you. It's just weird. It's weird at best, but it's manipulative at worst, because it kind of leaves you feeling, whoa, this person's like really spiritual and so on. And whatever then diminishes your freedom to maybe not really witness with that word is manipulative or coercive. And so we want to give people the freedom. That's why we encourage people to test a word. Have the freedom to test a word. If I share something with you, you've often heard me say, and I'll say, you know, don't just take it because I'm the pastor. Go and talk to one or two people. Test that word to see if it really witnesses and resonates in your heart. I want to give you that freedom. And we should give one another that freedom. I'm sure we've all got some stories we could tell around that one. The second one is fear. We tend to I'm not saying all of us, but sometimes, particularly those in Christian leadership, can try to use fear as a tactic to keep people in check. I mean, how many times haven't you heard a salvation message that's laced with descriptions of hell and the kind of consequences, as true as that might be? Often the motivation is to use fear to get people to come to Christ. Now, as Dennis Lewis a few weeks ago said, fear might get you to come to Christ, but it won't keep you following him. Only the love of God will keep people following him. And so I think subtly, we can, with the best of intentions, want people to really consider their lives and their eternal destinies. But if we coerce them too far, we put pressure on them not to make a choice where they are free. And they're free to actually reject it if they want to. And so we need to be very careful that we don't use threats or intimidation to try and keep people in check, even in the kingdom. You might have stories of being in a church where the leadership were quite restrictive and quite, you know, dogmatic on certain things, and would often use intimidation tactics to keep people in line. The reality is we're given freedom, and you should be able to have that freedom to make up your own mind. I'm not talking about dishonoring authority, but I'm just talking about the freedom of your own conscience, the freedom to love the Lord as you see fit, without coercion from others and that kind of manipulation to do whatever they say you must do, particularly if it's outside the word of the Lord. And so we need to be very careful of those kind of threats and the use of fear. It's often how cults start, because a cult leader, he doesn't start out as a cult leader, he just starts out as a charismatic figure and uses a lot of fear and intimidation to keep people in line. And they can't think differently to the leader, they can't have their own opinions, and that's how cults form. Because eventually then people just go along with the leader and threats of intimidation keep everybody in line. And that's not the heart of the gospel. It's not the heart of the kingdom. God gives us the freedom to choose. He gives us the freedom to walk away at any moment. A third thing that can happen in church is often the kind of manipulation around money. And this probably affects wealthier people more than others. But many a pastor will tell you how he's been manipulated by people who are big givers in the church. And all of a sudden, they don't like a new project, or they don't like where the church is going. And so either one or a number of them will come, and they'll sit down with the pastor or the leadership and say, listen, we're just concerned about the way things are going. And subtly or not so subtly, they're going to say, well, you know, if things don't change, we might need to reconsider our giving to this church. Now, that is just manipulative right off the bat. And those individuals just have no idea, no concept of what biblical giving is all about. They're using their money as a tool to try and move leadership instead of honoring leadership. Hey, listen, if they don't like where the church is going, they have the option. They have the freedom to leave the church. But they don't have the freedom to now try and manipulate things in the way it should go. And so that's often how many people withholding giving when they don't like the way things are going. And they talk about it. And they talk about it very proudly. And it always has baffled me, because the reality is it's just downright rebellious. It's just dishonoring to the leadership. I have no problem with somebody saying, listen, Trevor, I'm concerned where the church is going, and I just feel for my family and I, we're going to move on to another church, etc., and we're going to tithe there, and we're going to give to that church. You are free to do that. I'm not going to beg you to stay. And I've had people say that to me. But I'm not going to be manipulated. And I don't think anybody should be by people that come with money to decide and try and influence the leadership of the church and what the church should do. And I hope you understand my heart in saying that. I believe in godly giving and so on. I believe in people raising their concerns. But there's a biblically sound way to do that. And then there's also a manipulative way. Number four, God in the unity. Because we all have things that might concern us from time to time in the body of Christ. We don't necessarily like everything that's going on. And so there's always this danger of a little group forming, a little group of disgruntled people. And now they want to, they don't want to come to leadership, but they make it known in circles. You know, we're not happy. And the leadership of the church is not taking notice of us. They haven't come forward to raise any issues, but there's this disgruntled group. And when asked, well, who are these people? No, they're just some concerned people. Guys, that's not walking in the light, is it? You know, we at Lighthouse, we want to do everything in the light, because it's God honoring and it keeps the devil at bay. And by doing things in light, it means that if you ever had a concern, you have the right to come to the eldership and raise that concern. But when there's a little grumbling group That is a recipe for the enemy to kind of get in there and to start stirring up dissension and division in the body of Christ. And it looks all very, you know, very spiritual because all these people are very concerned. They're very concerned and they're really praying for the church and they're praying for the leaders, etc. But it's manipulative because it's trying to steer the church or the leadership in a direction in non-biblical ways, in ways that are not sanctioned through the Word of God. If you have a concern, you go to the leadership. That is biblical. And so we don't have these little grumbling groups and so on. In some church constitutions, there is a clause that if a group of about 10 people are unhappy, they can call a church meeting. They can discuss it. Now, I'm not in favor of that because I don't think it's always necessary. But there may even be channels to do that. But when we're not following the channels and we're going to grumble and moan and we're going to try and get a word out there so that people side with us to try and influence the outcome of where the church is going, that's problematic. And actually, when we break it down, it's manipulative. And I'm sure some of you might have stories of being sucked into that in situations in the past. The last one is probably quite a common one. And it's one that I think for some we might carry a sense of pain, and that is where some heavy-handed leadership teams or pastors, often very strong controlling types, churches growing, etc., but they can get quite heavy-handed, and they use this word, the whole thing of submission a lot. Well, you know, you submit to your leaders, and of course, that is biblical, but the question, and we can talk around this quite a bit tonight, how far does submission go? Because submission is biblical, and it's good to honor authority. But what happens if that authority is calling on all sorts of things to be submitted to, maybe even beyond the area of Scripture and so on? There are many churches where if you're a couple, a young adult couple, and you want to start dating, before you do that, you have to go to the church leadership and have that approved by the church leadership. No, I'm not so sure. I mean, we don't do that lighthouse. I'm not so sure that that's what church leadership is required to do. And look, if that's the way the church operates, that's the way it operates. And if you're a member there, then you would know that. But how far does that go? And if you disagree with these strong leadership teams, often you labeled as rebellious, where maybe actually you're just a leader yourself, or you're thinking differently, or you have a different opinion. And it's a very fine line, isn't it? And in fact, it's probably a good place to have some discussion tonight around how far does submission and honoring go. Personally, I think it comes down to the heart. It comes down to the heart of honoring leadership, but also for leaders honoring people. Remember, we talked about boundaries on Sunday morning. One of the key components of a boundary is respect. I want to respect you as I expect you to respect me. And so as members are respecting leadership and leaders are respecting members, in other words, members are giving leaders the freedom to lead and the leaders are giving the members the freedom to not to disobey and anarchy prevails, but to have their own opinions with a heart that still wants to honor and serve the leadership and the vision and values of the church. So those five things, as you've been listening tonight, maybe some stories have come to mind and maybe just some questions around how do we practically guard and keep the unity in the Spirit, and particularly talking about keeping manipulation and coercion at bay and keeping the enemy out. And so that's what we're going to talk around tonight. Maybe you just want to pick up on some of these thoughts that I've mentioned and talk around that tonight. Here's the bottom line. There are two things that we looked at on Sunday. Number one, the only form of control that is sanctioned in the Bible is self-control. I have no right to try and control anybody else, not to control their thinking, their behavior, or anything else. And so we give people the freedom to choose to differ with us, to believe different things, etc. Secondly, that Galatians 5 verse 1 says, it was for freedom that Christ has set us free. Any form of manipulation and coercion diminishes that freedom. And we need to be creating an environment in the church where great freedom is given to people. Obviously with limits. We're going to talk around those limits tonight. But where freedom is given for people to think differently, for people to raise a concern, for people to express themselves, all in God-honoring ways. And there are many God-honoring ways. And so freedom and self-control, those are two key issues that really summarize the heart of what we're talking about. So enjoy your discussion, and God bless.